And for people that don't know, Rhonda, I mean, it wasn't exactly like you had lived a life of the secret before. I mean, you struggled with negative beliefs about money and all these things. So you really were learning in the lab while you were developing the movie. Can you speak a little bit about your upbringing and how unsecret it was or what it was like?
Yeah. I'm humble. My beginnings were very humble. My parents didn't have much money. I mean, I was very blessed in that I had a very safe, secure family life. My parents were madly in love with each other. I had, I'm one of five girls. I'm the oldest of five girls. And so we did not have any money, but we weren't aware that we didn't have money. And so it was very humble life and public schools and all of that. I did have an experience when I was 12, what I would call a kind of divine experience that, because I was asking, you know, is there a God? Like I really wanted to know. And I had this experience where I was left in no doubt that there was a God. And so that happened at 12. But then, I mean, I just went on with my life. I thought all of the things that everybody thinks, that to have money, you have to work hard and struggle, or you're going to be a bad person, or you're going to hurt other people. And that, you know, born on the wrong side of the tracks. Well, this is just my luck. You know, I wasn't born into a wealthy family, so I have to accept, you know, the limitations of the family that I was born into, or the education that I had, or the place that I was born. And that good things can happen to, you know, bad things can happen to good people. You know, you can be in the wrong place at the wrong time. All of those things, you know, all those fearful thoughts, I had all of them. And so, no, I didn't have a spiritual life. And, you know, I would look back and think, how did I ever survive? Because I can remember talking to girlfriends about, you know, gossiping things, and like we would just talk the whole night about, and I'd be like, how did I ever survive that, you know, being so negative? Like we get on a negative tangent, and you know, it's so amazing that I should have noticed. Why didn't I notice that when I was talking about negative things, which are things I don't want, that my feelings would plummet? I mean, you just can't talk about negative things without your feelings really plummeting and feeling really bad, which is just our perfect warning system to say, stop what you're doing, you know. But not at all a spiritual life. I think one of the things for me that my mother used to say about me is that I was very giving. That's kind of the only sort of spiritual quality that I felt that I had. Always wanted to be a good person, wanted other people's approval, you know, all of the things that we all suffer from. and it was just on that night of the 9th of September 2004 at 9:30 p.m., By 10:15, my whole life had changed.
And is it true that you had tears dripping from your eyes onto the page of the book?
Okay. I did. I can so clearly remember, because I was in despair that night. That 2004 was a really rough year for me, and my father had died really suddenly young and in the March, and my parents just had the greatest love affair I've ever seen. And so my mother was completely grief-stricken. I was, no coincidence, making six films on unsolved murders. So a really, right, really tough subject. And so I just had the worst year imaginable. Everything that went wrong, you know, could go wrong, went wrong. And so by the 9th of September, my health was terrible. My relationships were in tatters because I hadn't seen anybody. I was sleeping on edit room floors and trying to like get these six movies together. And I had my accountant call on that night of the 9th of September, and said to me, my director had run $2 million over budget and that I was going to lose everything in the next 30 days. And I hung up. It was so amazing, Brian. Like I have replayed this night over and over. I hung up the phone, and it was a hard line then. As I hung the phone, it rang again. And I said, what is it, Martin, who was my accountant? But it wasn't Martin, it was my mother. I didn't even recognize her. She was sobbing, and my mother, she'd always be strong in front of us and never let us see, you know, that she was suffering. And she just said she couldn't go on. You know, it was the September, my father had died in the March, and I was a long way away from her. So I talked to her for quite a while. I said to her, I'll be there in the morning. And I made sure that she was fine. And I hung up from her. And you know what? I had been Miss Fix-It all of my life. Solve all the problems. Whatever problems came along, I would fix it. I would fix it. Put out the spot fires. These two, I could not do. It was overwhelming. And so I just collapsed in despair and sobbing. And my daughter, who's in her 20s, so nonchalantly kind of walked out, and I was like, broken in pieces. And she said, oh, what's wrong? And I didn't want to go into it. I just said, oh, some things have gone wrong. And she walked away, and I thought, figures, you know. And then she came back with this photocopied bulldog clip thing, and she said, oh, here, read this. It'll help. And, I mean, look, it was my whole world was falling in. Why would I read this thing that she gave me? But I did. You know, I sat down, and the tears were pouring, and I can just so remember the tears hitting the ink and the ink running as I was reading it. And but that was the science of getting rich. And I just knew everything from that book. I knew that there was no death. I just knew so much. And it was one of the most incredible moments of my life that changed my life completely. And so blessed, Brian. I don't know why, but just blessed.
And when you read that book back, you said that you noticed that there's things that you learned that night, there's things you channeled into that night that aren't in the text of the book. So
that's right.
Other things were just coming into
your brain. Somehow or
another. Right.
Sorry.
Other things were coming into your brain, and you were just getting all this creative energy from who knows where, but it wasn't necessarily the words on that page.
No, it wasn't. It was like the in between the lines.
Yeah.
Like in between the words, I was getting this massive kind of download. And I've thought back to that night, and what was it, you know, I was in despair, but what was it that allowed that to happen? And the best word that I can come up with was surrender, because I had no idea how to fix these two problems that were overwhelming. And so I just surrendered. And in that moment of surrender, everything just came.